Let you know, I'm one of the core developers and technically chief agitator for Inkscape, which means I get to run around and raise issues and try to get things moving. Sometimes people listen, sometimes they just ignore me, but we'll see. What I'm here to present today is just an overview of Inkscape, where it's been. We're coming up on our next release, 0.4.7. We're actually in the middle of the release process. We've started our initial soft freeze. No more features should be going in, just bug fixing and visual issues like that. So, for a quick overview, what is Inkscape? Open source standards compliant SVG editor with a very active community. For a figure here, most people have at least heard of it, even if they haven't checked it out or seen it. So we'll leave that for a little more follow-up if you want to ask someone next to you or ask me afterwards or anything else to go into a little more detail on Inkscape in general. This is really, we're going to try to see what's been going on and what's going to show up next. So to cover where we are now is that our last release prior to this took just about a year compared to, say, 3 or 4 month average we had been hitting. So that 0.4.6 was a very, very long release cycle. And here we have our icon for 0.4.6. 0.4.7 went even longer, which for us is not so good. It's, compared to commercial software, we're still on a pretty tight schedule, but it's nowhere near where we'd like to be and where we had been. Now, part of this, I'd say, is the blessing and the curse of the agile approach we use. One of the tenets we have is that our source tree has to always build. If you want to check something in, you can't break the build. Also, it has to be usable. If you check something in, you can't break any existing functionality. If you are wanting to experiment, make a branch, share it with other people, all sorts of things like that. But what that leads is that since we're trying to keep it very iterative and quick and refined and usable at any time, many people are just using the latest version from SVN source, and so there's not as much pressure to get a release out. It's not like no users are going to get their hands on it till after we do a release. The project has taken a different approach. Now, that's good for many things, but one of the bad things is that did contribute somewhat to the release delay. But the main reason it was taking so long is because of our refactoring. Similar sounds like what Blender was also having to do, is that we have to purge some of the worst legacy code, ghosts that have been haunting us, and stuff that's getting in the way of putting in new features. So we declared that once we got 4.6 out, because it was getting so slow to try to add new stuff, it was just time to clean up. So we'll take the hit, take a lot more time now, get the internals cleaned up so that later we can get some more happening. So once we clean up the internal architecture, then we can make other decisions after, because then it will be easy. Right now it's a little hard to see, or at least it was a year ago, a little hard to see what goes in where, how to fix this, how can we do anything. Once we've cleaned it up, it allows for new decisions to be made a lot more easily. We removed a lot of legacy code and replaced. And one of the refactoring things was moving to the external library for our vector math and such, and that's lib2geom, which is an interesting standalone project, and also it's been split out so that it can be reused by others in other contexts as needed. So this is the core math engine. And it strikes me, it's a little bit similar to what Gagle and GIMP had going on, is that, you know, there's a core bit of functionality that does one task, and then there's an application that uses it for another. And it's not quite to the same scale, maybe, as and jump that you get from that, but just by separating out the functionality, the math itself can be worked on separately. And also, new features and new functionality can be explored within a little tool and not within the whole application. So you can build things much more quickly, and you're just trying to test this graphics vector library, not the app. Now coming in for some of the new features, many new features came in. We have summer code additions, and of course, one of the delays with any open source project, you really get real life intrusions. Also, especially over this past year with the economy going around, various contributors have had to deal with either maintaining a job or finding a new job as companies go under, and that happens with anything. It's real. It's life. It'll go on. So, as I'm going to present, what is in there, what's new, one of the things is to just go look at our 047 release notes. They're updated as code is changed, features added, and they're decently organized. So we have that up to date. And one of the other things is just I can run through a few of the new features myself. So I'll jump back over and have handily cached. If you go to our Inkscape wiki, release notes 047 has the release notes. Summary of all the functionality, a few things in there. A few new tools, some of the details. But we want to just try to bring it up and see if we can make it crash a few times just off the local build I pulled early this morning. And here we have the latest and greatest, which looks very similar to what we've had before. Main tools on the side, primary tar on the top, context-sensitive toolbar here. One of the things you might see right off the bat, we've got a new note or new snapping toolbar, which lets you control snapping controls a lot more. Placement of this may or may not change before release. The feature's in, so we might need to clean up its position in the UI as a bug. If not, that's what we're going to go with. So I was going to just do a little rundown real quickly of some of the highlights through here. We have listed the refactoring effort, migration, tools. Node tool has had some improvements. See if I can make some nodes, pick them. Now, not sure if this is coming through very well on the projector, but as I'm moving over this path, there's a little highlight coming on it. If I switch to stroke, it might. It's not showing up as well. But one of the things is there's highlighting as you come onto a path in the release. Now, again, this is just what I pulled the snapshot early this morning. Couple of things may or may not work as final. So there's a lot more snapping support in here. New type of node, the auto smooth node, has been added. If that's something that might interest you, read the release notes, see what it is, play with it a little. The tweak tool, which is this. If anyone is not familiar with it, is this tool that lets you push and merge and meld things and has all sorts of modes. And that has had a lot of rework. And that's kind of like turns vector into putty molding, lets you smear a vector around and do some things with that. There are, touchpad a little sensitive, sorry. There are a few things on that. Jitter, scale, rotate, so you can do all these interesting things in a malleable, artist-friendly way, which, since I'm primarily now a coder, not an artist, I can't really showcase as well for you, and including all sorts of keystrokes there to make everything happen. our classic calligraphy tool has a little bit of erasing now. So you can remove from the selected path, or you can add to it. And that's similar to additional tool we have. PaintBucket eraser tool was one of our new items added recently. Now the GUI auto, we have a GUI auto switch. So if you have a tablet, the tool selected on the side will switch depending on, say, which end of the Wacom you pull onto it. That's not quite functional at the moment. This is, I'm running the latest Jaunty, trying to get it working again under all distros. But we have a tool now for erasing. And one of the things people like to do is go into this classic, oh, how can I draw without an eraser? They get trained by bitmap programs and others to do this, so let me scribble. It erases now. Well, nice. But that's more of a bitmap type operation. And that's not, for me, that's not the primary function. The primary mode that we have it coming up in is a kind of touch delete. So you're using your eraser, and you have a complex drawing with lots of shapes, and you want to get rid of some of them, but not all of them. So we just, get that guy and that one and there. Boom. Whatever you touch is erased as a vector object. So it can operate both as a bitmap and a vector operation. Maybe we need to get something a little more to help people understand that, you know, bitmap painting and vector painting can be different and need to be used differently. Pen and pencil have some improvements, and including our Spirus blinds, which are a Ralph Levine item. Let me make another. So we have a couple examples done by an artist so that you can see the style of things that it makes easy. So here's, in our general screenshot, this might be one of the things people have seen on Spiros. This type of freeform curly art makes it very easy for an artist to do. If I was an artist, I could do even more. And see, there's some pen and pencil can automatically do a few things, a sketch mode, which is slightly interesting. So if I have the pencil tool and I go to draw, okay, I did a shape, whatever. Not quite the right shape I wanted. Maybe a little rounded, maybe a little more like that. I'm holding on the Alt, I keep adding more to refine it till I get about the shape I want in this red path, let go, and that's the shape that gets drawn. Unfortunately, I'm not up to speed on how to use this as an artist, but there are some cases where this is really handy. Helps you get something roughed in, and actually maybe a little more with the mouse, because when you're trying to draw with a mouse versus a tablet, it's a bit harder. Path effects, I brought up our release notes, because as I said, they're a bit useful. Some of the effects you can do, sketching, hatching, caution, knot. And all the details are on our README, so you can drill down as you needed what you're interested in. Here we have a section of our release notes that aren't filled in yet. By the time we go to release, it'll be out. Pace, path effects, dealing more and more with path effects have been improved. Live path effects we've had for a while now can apply to groups. So you apply the path, you edit the original, and it goes on. So this is now, what is a path effect? Well, that's covered under base prior release. So we're going into that. A little more interest here, technically what's going on is we reworked a lot of our internals for PDF support in export, especially our creation of PDF and PostScript now are using Cairo. So we're drawing through Cairo and using Cairo to actually generate the PDF. One of the things for people doing print work, that means you'll get a more consistent PDF out, and as soon as Cairo supports CMYK and other color spaces, you'll get that in your output PDFs. We have it in the input for a while, but we'll push it through, and we're actively working with the Cairo developers to make that happen. Minor note that you can do it from the command line also to create PDFs out of SVGs. UniConverter, so we're reusing an existing open source project to do some of the heavy lifting on certain things so we can get in and out. So that's a very nice project in and of itself. So when anyone starts to ask us, well, oh, why don't you add support for this format or that format? We say, well, wouldn't it be appropriate for UniConverter? Put it in there and everyone can do it, not just us. So we try to keep that running and shared. HPGL export, JavaXF support. We also have had XAML in there. I didn't do it, don't blame me. One key point we had a patch, someone brought in autosave. Now this is different from the existing crash handler. Right now Inkscape has a crash handler so that if it goes down, it tries to take whatever you had in memory and write it out to disk so you at least you'll be able to recover something for most of the time. Occasionally it won't catch it right, but a lot of times that will help save someone. Autosave is different, so that lets you do a timed backup as you're working. You say, save my work every 5 minutes. And you also get control over how many backups it's saving. So you can say, keep my last 100 versions saving every 2 minutes. Among other things, this lets an artist have a little more freedom to go wild, experiment, and it can be viewed as a kind of mini source control thing for that. If he's spends 20 minutes doing something that ends up not panning, he can have timed backups to look at and load up one of the older ones instead and restore to. And the other thing is, in the case when an autosave or crash handler save is not going to help you, you'll have the autosave from whatever time period to go back to instead. Ooh, we renamed a menu. Oh, fancy. Okay, I'll move on. The new many effects, many paths have been changed. Some of the extension API has been changed. So the parameters we're passing, so our Inkscape extensions are just little, almost like mini CGI program kind of approach where we call out some other program. Could be Perl, Python, Java, command line, Bash shell, we have some written in. With a definition, and we have a little, an extension has an INX file that defines it, and very much like Blender was talking about, they have a dynamic UI that whatever properties are needed and whatever input parameters are needed, also these will, whatever extension you write it in, or whatever language you write an extension in, you'll get a consistent GUI with the right parameters for the right data types automatically. Ask for a Boolean, you get a checkbox. Ask for an integer, you'll get an entry range. Items like that. And a few others so that you can make it not even show up in the GUI itself if you need that. So there's a, but that's only on the extensions. Now, and again, that's another thing, is a lot of functionality in Inkscape comes in as extensions and can be run through that way. Filters can be edited, saved, cleaning up a little of our internal CSS output. Little more internals. This is a slightly more interesting item for some people trying to interoperate. Is this, we're now preserving the script tag. So if you put some dynamic functionality into your SVGs via the script, you pull it back out, it'll still be there. So you can edit them without losing it, as opposed to having to edit the SVG, then put the script back in separately. It's just a little hard for people who are trying to do advanced SVG. And then one item that was pulled in was initial SVG font support. And I'd like to stress that's initial. This was a Google Summer of Code project. It's a bit of a big project. You have to add some UI, you have to add editing, you have to add all sorts of other things, and all the internals to actually make them show up. Now, we have some of the font design workflow coming through. This is definitely one where this is the prototype, this is the first iteration. You can get something happening. Use this, and especially give us feedback, give us maybe a hand if you want to code a little, to make this actually work well. And I personally think this is one of those ones where font designers know what to do. Programmers, or even your average graphic artist, doesn't know how to design a font, but the font designers know. So this is where we can improve that. It's in as an initial early support. Grids, guide snappings have been improved. Go through there. Oh, we have a spell checker integration now. Shell mode. On our layers dialog, you can solo a layer, so you can get one layer with a quick click, turn one layer off and others not. A little more internals. In UI changes, probably one of the interesting ones is that our UI has now switched all toolbars over to standard GTK. So the prior problem where on small screens it would not work well, that has been taken care of. Because now this is, the tools will collapse and get out of the way so the window can shrink up. And for small form factors, EEPCs, other netbooks, this will make the UI usable on it now. And we have various bug fixes and other info. So, trying to sum up what's new is in the release notes. Check it out, see what's in there. There's GUI changes, there's new features, there's internal hooks, there's scripting hooks. So there's a lot in there for everyone of whichever level. Oh, we had the demo. I guess I didn't push the demo because we didn't crash. Now, what's coming up next? Again, for Google Summer of Code, we have 5 main projects now running. Connector tool improvements, so they will be more useful for diagramming, orthogonal, auto-tracing, multiple connector points on an object instead of just its center, so that you can actually get something out of it. CMYK color managed workflow, which is really arbitrary ICC-based whatever you want. So similar to Peter mentioned, that it's not CMYK, it's the plates, and arbitrary ones, whatever they are. We now have a project to get that implemented for our GUI and our internals. Our GUI mainly, because most of our internals actually will support arbitrary channels now. Inkscape API. Now this, as opposed to last year's Summer of Code, there was a little bit of scripting and other things. This is trying to focus on our internal API so that code is going to be consistent and can then be exposed to extensions or internal code so that it will stay in step and can be exposed to extensions. And eventually we're targeting having so that plugins can have a live DOM to operate instead of streaming in the SVG input, processing it, and sending back the output, so that extensions will become more and more a first-class citizen in the Inkscape world. LibTubeGeom, which we're doing that integration, so that any new features, experimental features, can be pulled in there or worked on there separately and then pulled in. And when you're using the node tool, doing multiple path editing, so you can edit multiple paths, nodes from all sorts of things all at once. And so now I just want to mention that as we're going to release, probably we're targeting by the middle of next month to have this out, then we're going to kick in for brand new stuff. And this timing is really good because in the past, LGM has given rise to all sorts of things. Some of the features, like the color, initial color management, went in a week after leaving from LGM. So this time, what is it going to be? That's really up to you. So we'll see what we can make happen. Yeah. Thank you. And any quick questions?
We are quite almost over with time, but some quick questions, yes?
For the autosave feature, how does it handle if you have multiple instances of Inkscape open? Does it keep separate histories for each of them, or is it like a mixed bag?
The autosave, well, we have in our bug hunt part of our release process, we're addressing that. We have a few bugs filed. One of the things is, I believe it's basically per document. So it will autosave a document. Now, if you have a document open in two separate instances and you're editing in both, it may not behave well, but that may not be the program's problem.
What we're doing in Blender for that kind of thing is we're doing it per PID. So if you have one file open in two different instances of Blender, it does autosaves for the two of them separately.
Yeah, so that's a good idea. We might make sure to include that so that we can get better coverage. But like I said, we have a couple things entered already, so we'll get that cleaned up. And
my second question is perhaps a bit more philosophical. Do you think having Inkscape in a 0.something version number hinders your look for the general public? Like, people might see it as not yet stable.
Basically, yes, and that is intentional.
All right.
So once we have sufficient functionality and support SVG sufficiently, which I believe we're targeting SVG Tiny support, which we're actually very close to now, then we're going to bump to 1.0. Because then it goes with the expectations. If it's 0.something, people aren't going to think it's quite there, because we're trying to get it to the point where it is solid. It will do the job. Not just it won't crash, but I mean, if someone wants to do anything with SVG, we can do it. So as soon as that happens, which we're probably pretty close, I mean, the next version might be 1.0. I don't know. It depends how many people jump in and contribute, or even give us test cases to point out where we have to finish up. And then we can finish up, and as soon as we hit that coverage level, we're bumping the number.
Great.
Any others? Oh.
I love the uh-oh as soon as I put my hand up. So I was very heartened to hear that you feel you can do, you know, a reasonably complete SVG coverage. So does that mean that I should be getting on the mailing list and complaining when there's something that's not right, or you can't import a particular SVG, or you change it, or whatever like that? I mean, I heard about the dropping of the script, and that's been fixed, that's good. But those sorts of things, is now a good time for me to start bugging you about all those different things?
Well, we're in the middle of the release cycle.
Not for this release.
Yes, so if it were something it's a bug with one of the features in this release, yes. Otherwise, just after, as soon as we get 4.7 out, that's some of the first stuff we want to get. Sample edge cases we have to test, samples. If you can get us samples, especially of those, that makes it so much easier to fix.
One particular thing I'm thinking of is that at one point, Inkscape required all text to be basically inside a T-span, inside a text. Mm-hmm. And that was how you generated it internally. Oh. But most people don't code like that. And If you wrote some SVG and then brought it into Inkscape to edit it, it would tend to not use that text
I would say one thing is, for any text-based issues, go ahead, don't hold off. If anyone has any text issues, go ahead and send them now, because I forgot to include one other item. Is under the I think it's the Linux Fund. One of the contribute to open source umbrella organizations has funded one developer, outside of everything else, to work on our text tool and text improvements. And that's started already. So if you have text issues, go ahead and raise them on the list, and we can get them covered.
OK, great. Thanks.
Are you planning to provide Python bindings for lib2gm?
That?
Because actually, it covers a lot of features I'm missing in Cairo. So or if you would make it in such a way that it plays nicely together with Cairo. Yeah, I would love that.
Yeah, now, one of the good news is Lib2GeoM people and Cairo people talk all the time. Everybody knows everyone, and we're trying to integrate things in the best way. Lib2GeoM is also a separate, intentionally standalone thing, and they have what they call toys. So you can write a little tiny app to try one feature and use it standalone. So the intention is that it can be wrapped with anything and called from anything. So it's not it's very much not Inkscape specific. It's a completely standalone and should be reusable. So just follow up with the Lib2GeoM development.
Because I was talking with the Cairo developers, and well, they told me like you should try to push the Lib2GeoM developers to, yeah, to make it more well, to make it interoperate with Cairo.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So pass through them, and that's Mental, Peter Mulder, Nathan, maybe a couple other guys are focusing on that.
One last question. No. Okay. Thank you very much.
Right. Thank you.